In the 16th century, there was cultural upheaval in the European continent. This became known as the Protestant Reformation. For years, the Catholic Church had its grips on the European people, gaining their prosperity by manipulating the vulnerable. And as the tide started to turn within the theology of the European people, the Catholic Church started to lose its grips on power. But before we go any further, you know what to do. Please hit that subscribe button and give us a like. Also, a very, very, very big thank you to all of our producers of Esoteric Atlanta, as well as our patrons. Without you guys, we would not be able to do what we do. We appreciate you. We love you. And we are so entirely grateful to you. Welcome to Esoteric Atlanta. My name is Bryce, and today we are going to be talking about part two of the Devil's Family with the Loudun possessions. Weeks ago, we released part one of The Devil's Family, where we spoke about a letter that was allegedly written by a possessed nun. If you caught that episode, you know that that nun had a very interesting family bloodline. Now, I'll place that episode down in the description box below if you missed it. However, you don't necessarily need to watch part one first before watching this story. This story also has to do with possessed nuns. It also has to do with the politics of the time. And yes, of course, it also has to do with the Catholic Church. Poitou, France was a province in the northwestern region of France. And in the late 1500s and early 1600s, this area became a hotbed for French Calvinists, also known as Huguenots. As we spoke about in a previous episode, from 1562 to 1598, the French War of Religion wreaked havoc all over the countryside of France. During this time, Protestants in France were heavily attacked and discriminated against by the Catholics. In 1598, King Henry IV of France, first monarch of the House of Bourbon, signed the Edict of Nantes. This was signed to give temporary relief to the persecution of the Huguenots. Now, as you who have been on this channel for a while know, we have extensively covered the House of Bourbon as well as King Henry IV of France. If you happen to miss those videos, I will place those videos as well down in the description box below. Now, it's important to note that before King Henry IV of France became King Henry IV of France, France was ruled by the Valois line, cousin to Henry, but technically a different house under the same bloodline. And with this house, more specifically, the matriarch who married into the family, Catherine de' Medici, who was from the very powerful Italian banking family, and also notoriously was a Satanist. Catherine de' Medici had many relatives who had been popes and were obviously heavily involved in the Catholic Church, as the Catholic Church, since its inception, has actually been more on the dark side than the light side. Henry IV of France, who was a distant cousin to the Valois line, was a Calvinist. His mother herself had converted to this new faith. However, when Henry became the monarch of France, he was forced to convert to Catholicism, to keep Catholicism the official religion of France. But because of his upbringing, he did have a special tender spot for the new Protestants. Therefore, he wanted to make sure that the Protestants in France were granted relief from all of the persecution by the Catholics. This decision to show leniency towards the Huguenots would end up costing Henry his life. And once more, there would be tension in the country of France between the Huguenots and the Catholics. Much later than our story in 1685, Henry's very famous grandson, King Louis XIV, the Sun King, would end up revoking his grandfather's Edict of Nantes, once again making the Protestant faith illegal. Now, even though our story takes place in 1634, I feel like a brief understanding of the timeline helps us understand just how high tension was between the Protestants and the Catholics, between the monarch and its people. Now, during this time as well, a lot of the Huguenots of France did start to make their way over to the New World, to the Americas. A lot of us who live on this continent, who are of European descent, have ancestors, whether from France or Germany or England or wherever, that were simply Protestants and did not want to be persecuted for their faith, hence they came over to the New World. Now, a lot of the people from the area of Poitou went over to what is now Nova Scotia in Canada. As I said, this wasn't just about theology. Along with the Protestant Reformation came this new idea of government, a government that was run by the people for the people. At this time, the people who were in support of the Catholic Church were also in support of the monarchy, whereas people that supported the Protestant Reformation were in support of a change in government. A government based on democracy. Urbain Grandier was born in Mayen, France in 1590. He was brought up in a Catholic family and he did end up attending a Jesuit college. His uncle was very high up and very powerful within the Jesuit order. Now, those who know a little bit about the Jesuits, besides the fact that they're totally dark and awful, they were also created to counter the Protestants. In 1617, at the age of 30, Urbain was picked by his uncle to be the parish priest in Loudun. Loudun was in the area of Poitou. So obviously he was coming in to be a priest in a highly charged Huguenot area. Given this position by his uncle made Urbain a very, very wealthy man, and a lot of people were very resentful for this nepotism. Urbain was also allegedly a ladies' man, very charming, very good looking, and pretty soon he got an interesting reputation in the town. In fact, it was believed by many in this time that he had fathered a child with the daughter of the king's prosecutor for the area. Let's just say Urbain was playing with fire. Now, because the area of Loudun was heavily Huguenot, there were walls that were built around the town to try to protect it. This was common during this time. In fact, Charleston, South Carolina, where I have a lot of heritage, back when it was being settled, when it was just Charlestown, also had walls around the town in order to keep Catholics out. It was a Protestant safe haven. During this time, there was a lot of political scuffle happening around this wall that circled Loudun. Of course, the Catholics, under the reign of King Louis XIII, wanted the walls down, where the Protestants, the Huguenots, wanted them kept up. Now, what's interesting about Urbain is that he actually supported the wall staying up, even though he was a Jesuit Catholic. In 1626, 9 years after Urbain became the parish priest for this town of Loudun, a nunnery was opened. In 1632, a lady named Jeanne de Angas presided over 17 nuns all around the age of 25. Legend states that Jeanne had quite the little crush on Urbain. And knowing full well that Urbain was a ladies' man and was actively, allegedly, writing a book opposing the idea that priests should stay celibate, Jeanne went for it. She tried to seduce this priest. Now, this priest, even though he was a ladies' man, allegedly was not into Gion. And as they say, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. Same year of Gion's advances on Urbain, as well as the year she actually took over the nunnery, a group of the nuns started to accuse Urbain of being a wizard. They accused him of witchcraft, of casting spells on them, and claimed that he had sent one of the most powerful demons, Asmondi, to do inappropriate adult stuff with them. You see, Asmondi is one of the demons of the seven deadly sins. He is the demon of lust. The nuns said that these spells caused them to desire Urbain. As these accusations started swirling around, Loudun was not only caught up in the political tensions of the Catholic Church versus the Protestants, but they were also coming down from being hit hard by the plague. Because of the plague, the nuns had been sequestered in a lockdown situation at the time that they claimed Urbain had cast his spells. While in this lockdown, at first the nuns started to claim that they were seeing visions of their dead relatives. However, once they claimed that they were being possessed by these demons and these demons were asking them to have relations with them, exorcisms were needed to be performed. The Archbishop of Bordeaux came down to Loudun to sequester the nuns and try to figure out what had caused this ruckus. Even though the nuns did blame Urbain, at first his name wasn't mentioned. They mentioned a bunch of other names, a bunch of other suspects that they were pointing the finger at to have caused all this demonic occurrence in their nunnery. But then, all of a sudden, Urbain became the culprit. As I said, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. All of this caught Urbain off guard, as he had never met the nuns personally. At this point, he filed what we would call today a defamation lawsuit. Those aren't the words they used back then, but that's what we call it today. He wanted to clear his name of these accusations. Once he filed his lawsuit, the nuns were sequestered again. This point, they started barking like dogs, vomiting, profusely sweating, swearing, crying. The Archbishop of Bordeaux definitely had quite a PR crisis on his hands. While the town of Loudun was dealing with the possessed nuns, the monarchy sent officials to take down the wall. Once the officials got there, the town formed their own militia and ran the officials off, saying, "Hell no, you're not taking down our wall." But on the 31st of May of 1634, the officials came back with warrants signed for the monarchy. This stripped Loudun of any state power so that the monarchy, the federal government, could take down that wall. This also stripped the courts of their power and placed the Catholic Church in charge of the possessed nun's case. Urbain was arrested for witchcraft. And for the next 2.5 months, the possessions and the exorcisms kept happening. On the 23rd of June, Urbain was brought into the town again from his prison so that he could be present for the exorcisms. Again, the state, the local state, had lost their power because of the taking down of the wall. Now the church was in charge of prosecuting this case. And having Urbain present for an exorcism was a way for them to try to see if this Jesuit priest was really guilty of the witchcraft he had been accused of doing. During this time, Urbain never once confessed to being a witch. He was subjected to incredible amounts of but he never cracked. At some point, evidence was brought forward to the church. This evidence appeared to be a written contract between Urbain and the devil. This contract was written backwards in Latin. Urbain said he had never seen this contract before, but seeing that at this time they didn't have any forensic investigation, it was up to the discernment of the church. Urbain was found guilty. He was told that he would be able to make a final statement before death, but every time he went up to speak, holy water was thrown in his face, causing him to choke and not be able to speak. He was told that as an act of mercy, he would be strangled before the pyre was lit, but allegedly that never happened. And Urbain was set on fire. He passed away in an extremely horrific way, with his ashes scattered all over Loudun. Now, the possessions at the nunnery continued to happen. In fact, they continued a few years after Urbain's death. But the death of Urbain wasn't in vain for the Catholic Church, because you see, because of this incident, the Catholics were able to convert many of these heathen Huguenots back to the Catholic faith and back in favor of the monarchy. Seems quite handy, if you ask me. Now, I know that the Jesuits are anything but Christian. I know that the Catholic Church really is anything but Christian. We know about the Lucifer Room underneath the Vatican. We know that Vatican means head of the serpent. And it would be very easy for us just to jump to the conclusion that Urbain was, in fact, a practicing witch wizard and was part of the Jesuit satanic cult. But I'm not so sure, because it seems to me that Urbain was used by the Jesuits and was used by this Luciferian agenda. Now, I have no way to prove this, but over the years, I've learned a lot about the dark arts. The side of God, the side of light, the side of love is a side of service to others. No one on the side of God would ever, ever cost another human being his life in order to manipulate people to come to the side of good, of God. However, all the devil does is manipulate and lie. I wouldn't be surprised if one day we learn that Urbain himself was innocent and was simply a pawn used by an organization that was bigger than him to try to get people back into the grips of what we know now that psyops are common. We now know what false. So was this a, back in the 1600s, a sacrifice of one man in order to collect the souls of many? Let me know what you guys think down in the comment section below. I hope that you guys are all having a wonderful Friday. A heads up for this weekend. This is the 4th of July weekend, which obviously is a holiday here in the United States. There will not be a Mystery Monday on Monday because of the holiday weekend, but I am working on getting a very special interview this weekend in line so that I will have something to air on Monday for you guys. I will definitely keep you all posted. I hope you guys have a wonderful 4th of July. Please be safe. Enjoy your fireworks. Enjoy your time with your family. God bless America. Lots of love to all the patriots out there who will be celebrating this weekend. As always, thank you so much to Josh McKay for doing our music. If you would like to purchase the full song, there is a link down in the description box below. And as always, thank you to Todd Roderick for helping me get this video out to you guys today. I will talk to you guys soon. Bye.